So the assumptions of linear regression can be satisfied only the next few conditions are met. Now, if you ask me, Prithvi, why should these assumptions be satisfied? These assumptions should be satisfied if you have to put these formulas of A and B. These A and B formulas are derived based on some assumptions. They can be applied only in certain conditions. But the confusing part here is that, hey Prithvi, you said that assumptions should be satisfied only then you apply this formula. But in actual, what we do is like we first apply this formula. Only we apply this formula, we get the equations, these equations. After these equations, we get y predictions. From these predictions, we get residuals. And we go and plot these residuals, plot, and then see whether the residual, whether the assumptions are met or not. Okay, only after residuals plot, we can decide whether A can be A applied, B applied. So these formulas can be applied. In case assumptions are not satisfied, then you discard the model completely. Discard. Or there are some modifications which we can do. Right? In general, if you remember early mathematical techniques anywhere, if there are some assumptions and conditions, we verify them. If it is not verified, then we don't apply at all. But in regression, what happens is that we apply, then we get residuals, and then we check, and then we say, hey, this is okay. And then if residuals are not satisfying certain conditions, you said like model is not okay. And again, all this in statistical context, okay? In the context where your customers or clients are strictly asking you to build a statistical model, not a machine learning model, not a search-based model. Right? Let's discuss the assumptions. So first assumption is like model should be linear. What do you mean by model should be linear? So if the model is linear, once you apply the regression and look at the residuals, all these residuals are randomly plotted. But if the model is not linear, the data is not linear, let's say, the data has non-linear patterns also, the residuals will look something like this. That means residuals still have some pattern. So this is something called as increasing variance pattern. Here you can see residuals can plot some sine curve, where some residuals are highly dense in the middle, and in the start it's this side, in the start it's this side. So when the residuals are not random, that means the data still has some patterns in it. If the data still has some patterns in it, don't go and apply the linear regression algorithm. So if I have to put it in the analogy perspective, if these residuals have some juice in it or patterns in it, you shouldn't apply linear regression. That means your linear regression is not effective in finding all the patterns. What are residuals? Nothing but your errors. If the errors are still showing some patterns, that means your linear regression is not able to take all the patterns from your data. So better not apply. So if you're applying, the residual should be pretty random. Look at this first graph. There's no pattern here I can find. So then I can go and say, hey, my linear regression is perfect. That's first pattern. The second assumption is homoscedasticity. What do you mean by homoscedasticity? Homo is constant, and scedasticity is nothing but a synonym of variance. That means constant variance. You expect a constant variance in the residuals. That is very important. By the way, what are these residuals? Y minus y bar. And this is your x on which you're plotting, right? So in the case one and case two, there is a constant increase in variance or there is a constant decrease in variance. In the case three, the variance is not changing. So this is homoscedastic. Only in homoscedastic cases, go and apply linear regression. In both one and two cases, this is called heterostatisticity. Heterostatisticity, or the variance keeps on changing. The variance in not in Y or X, the variance in residuals. There is a pattern in here. What is changing variance indicates in the residuals? That means there is some pattern still existing in linear regression, in your data, which your linear regression cannot capture. And that is the reason you shouldn't use linear regression. That means indirectly these people have formulated such techniques to tell us, hey, go and find another model. Hey, go and find some other case algorithm. Hey, go and do some other transformation so that we can apply. This is the second assumption. Any questions so far? How can the filtered out sugarcane be a residual? I feel residual could be one sugarcane might be more filtered and one is less filtered. Yeah, I couldn't get an image which shows more filtered sugarcane and less filtered sugarcane. I agree to your point completely. So, Bandhavi, which one you didn't tell you? Understand. This time I'll go and ask this sugarcane guy to do one perfectly, one not perfectly. Take a picture of that and put it out. I got... Okay, homoscedasticity. So first of all, what is variance? Variance is the degree of spread or degree of randomness in the data, right? Degree of spread. For example, you look at the residuals in the initial stages. They're spread only this much. But as you keep on increasing your X value, the variance is increasing. Right, as you keep increasing X, the variance in the error is increasing. That means, what is error? Error corresponds to Y. That means there is some increasing pattern which is not being captured by linear regression. That's why we don't apply linear regression if the variance is increasing or decreasing. Here do you notice, in the starting stages, variance is high. But as the time goes on, the variance is increasing. Not the time, as X goes on increasing. As X value increases, the variance is decreasing. This is not a good sign for linear regression because there is a pattern which is still not being captured. Understood now? Yeah. So whenever you get a pattern like this, simple and straightforward thing is like, hey, in this particular cases, your regression will not work very well. There are other models which work very well in such cases. And in the case where the variance is constant in the error terms, then you can go ahead and apply linear regression. Guys, just take this as a fact. Don't think about reasoning why. Because if you want to think about reasoning why, then you have to go about the derivation and of that statistical model. Why constant variance works, why changing variance doesn't work. Accept the fact that, okay, changing variance is a problematic thing for that formula. Could you explain residual fitted plot, please? I didn't get you, Abdul. You are asking me what is this plot? How to fit? Okay, previous slide. This one? Okay, you are asking me to explain Y and X. The Y and X are not, this is nothing but Y minus Y bar. And fitted value is nothing but your X. There are some textbooks wherein you do the residual plots with y also. y minus y bar versus y, and y minus y bar versus x. So both should give you the same assumptions actually. So I'm explaining you with this perspective, but here the fitted value means y actually. So that's why they use fitted, but we will show you with y minus y bar versus x plots only. Both residual plots are analysis is correct. Clear? Need not be. X is your y equal to bx plus a, right? Your independent variable. Bx plus a. Need not be between 0 and 1, but you, I think these graphs, when they are taken up, they standardized it. They standardized the x value, that's why they are between 0 and 1. And for residual plots, when you are doing for multiple x values, you still have to do it with respect to each other. That means y minus, in the case of multiple linear regression, Abdul's question was like, if you have only one x, this is what I do. In case of multiple linear regression, you have to do y minus y bar versus x1, y minus y bar versus x2, y minus y bar versus x3 and all, which with respect to each x you do it. With respect to v, each x you do it, and the linear relation should be satisfiable for all the x. Yes. Unfortunately, yes. But I mean, as I said, there are some transformations wherein you can use, and you can still say apply the algorithm. And there is one more logic here you use. So why are we verifying assumptions is because to prove that this is the best solution possible. To prove this is the best solution possible, A and B, algebraically correct, right? So you say that you use assumptions. So when assumptions are not satisfied, what happens is that you cannot prove it mathematically, but still you can say it's a closer solution. There might be more solutions which exist, but it is a closer solution. So you don't simply discard it. Again, as said, as per your client requirement, if they are mathematically looking for the perfect models, statistically proven correct, then you have to discard it, no other chance. But if you are more working on e-commerce or any other portals where you need some solution, which is a closer solution, approximation is okay, then you can apply it. Still apply it. It's homo and hetero, doesn't matter. Oh, okay. Discard the variable and not the model. Hey, by the way, that's another option actually. In fact, you can discard the variable and go ahead also. Yeah. In fact, there are techniques used. We will discuss once we go to hands-on also. I'll show you how to handle all these problems when residuals are not falling in place. There are transformations which are possible and you can still use them. And sometimes, homo and heteroscedasticity also, there are variance requirements. If it's huge, then you don't use it. Otherwise, you'll use it. Again, how much huge depends on problem statement. We are just at the start of all these things. But as you dig in deep, you'll understand. And third assumption is drift. Drift in your error terms. So here, all the error terms. Again, drift can also be equated to homo or heteroscedasticity. Homo and heteroscedasticity, when you talk about it, you're talking about increased or decreased variance. But here what happens is that residuals have a above drift or below drift, or residuals have a slope to them, the entire residuals. Here the entire residuals have a zero slope, which is what is required. But if you are having residuals with some slope, that means I can still fit another regression line here. So when residuals have a slope towards it, like that's what we call as drift. So when drift is in error terms, then again, no linear regression. Go for transformations or repeat the process again. So there should be no slope for residuals. That means there's no increasing trend or decreasing trend in the residuals. And finally, this is also very similar. This is also expressed as, I put both as third only, drift in error terms or independence of error terms. That means error terms must be random. So if there exists any correlation in the error terms, any pattern in error terms, then that means you're gone. It's the model is non-linear. Here, clearly there is a sine wave, so there is a problem. This is like more of sawtooth wave. There's a pattern. These are pretty much random, but looks like more pattern here. It's also there. And more going there. So independence of error term is expected. That's also the third term. And the final assumption, the fourth assumption, is errors should be normally distributed around the mean. What do you mean by errors should be normally distributed around the mean? That means most of your errors should be around zero, right? Around the mean. That means y minus y bar, y minus y hat should follow a normal distribution. That's what should people say. Y means most of your errors should be small. What is your mean error? Mean error should be close to zero only. Most of your errors should be small, and a very small number of your errors can be extreme. Very small number of your errors can be extreme. That's what the assumption means. Errors should be normally distributed around mean. Again, mean of errors only. Y minus y bar mean. So if you plot this and see, you'll be able to understand. You can't visualize it much better, but when we go to hands-on, I'll show it to you. So you remember this statement, which makes it easier. Most of your errors should be small on plus or minus side. Huge errors can be accepted only when they are in small quantities. That means 90% of your errors should be between minus 1 to 1. Only one or two errors can be minus 3 sigma or plus 3 sigma. Something like that.